Hey everyone, and thanks for dialing in today. Welcome to Rethink OT Dailies, 5-minute messages to renew the OT mindset and reignite your passion for the profession. I'm Michelle Eliason, and I'm a neurocentric occupational therapist and the creator of geriatricoccupationaltherapy.com. Let's jump in. Today's topic offers a specific perspective on a comprehensive OT evaluation. As a community-based practitioner, especially among adults, a comprehensive evaluation is crucial not only for our patients, but to advocate, promote, and utilize the full scope of OT practice. The next 4 minutes will be formatted like an evaluation and a soap note. Number one, subjective. The first element is building an adequate occupational profile to establish their occupational identity. This is crucial and sets us apart from our brothers and sisters in the ancillary field. We don't have the luxury of skipping over this section and heading straight for bottom-up areas, aka the objective section. Our vantage point is the subjective elements. The occupational history, profile, and identity is how occupational therapists hope to achieve their physical outcomes. This should be your longest section. The OTPF states, all aspects of the domain, including occupations, client factors, performance skills, performance patterns, and contexts and environments, are of equal value, and together they interact to affect the client's occupational identity, health, well-being, and participation in life. So that interview process is crucial. Number two, objective. This is your second most important section. Because we exist in a bottom-up world, we need objective measures. We need numbers and assessments for everything. At the bare minimum, you should have 3 assessment measures: 1 perceptual, 1 occupation-based, and 1 measuring body function, structure, or performance skill. When you have the luxury of more time, as I do in community-based practice, you can have a full comprehensive evaluation to include, but not limited to, CATS ADL, Lawton Brody IADL, range of motion, manual muscle testing, grip, strength, slums, or MMSE, the tug, 5-time sit to stand, Berg, and a perception assessment, like modified falls efficacy scale. Yes, it's a lot, but a full occupational profile, including functional ability, is crucial to maintaining quality of life over time. Number 3, assessment. After you have all of the information, which includes a caregiver interview if family roles are important, at this point you can begin to have a response. There is simply no way to do our job as an occupational therapist and ensure the plan is client-centered in a 15-minute evaluation. I get it. Some sites instruct us to do this. Unfortunately, most people don't know that occupational therapy is centered in psychosocial and perceptual motor elements. When you are working with the psyche, it takes time. By analyzing their occupational identity in conjunction with objective measures and medical history, an OTP can begin formulating a plan. Number 4, plan. Okay, finally, the plan. What are their goals? Are they realistic? Or do you need to validate their goals, use activity analysis, and break it into its parts? How long do they want to have therapy? How many days a week? How long for each session? Finally, what do you see as potential goals? Talk to your patient about what you think based on the objective measures, and then ask open-ended questions to determine if you guys are on the same page. If not, adapt. Always ensure your goals are erected in favor of your patient. There you have it, a comprehensive occupational therapy evaluation. Check out the website for a copy of the transcript. That's all for today. Thanks for listening. For more information, check out geriatricoccupationaltherapy.com. Talk to you tomorrow.